Slum sale, section 242C and section 50B. While section 242C explains what is the meaning of slum sale, section 50B provides how capital gains are to be computed in case of a slum sale. Right? So before I actually get on to the legal side of it, I will explain to you what is the meaning of slum sale. Let us say there's an assessee or a company which has two undertakings A and B. What I mean by undertaking is a unit or a division, right? Undertaking or unit or division, whatever you might call it. What this means is that this is a complete business in itself. So let's say if you are engaged into manufacture of soap and toothpaste, okay, this particular factory, part B, can be a separate unit in itself. Now, if this company sells this entire unit, this unit itself will comprise of what? It will have various plant and machinery, debtors, okay, creditors, and so on. So basically what happens is that these units are a complete business by itself. So they'll have assets, they'll have liabilities and everything. When instead of selling these individual assets, you sell the complete unit or the undertaking or a business, okay, to some other company, let's say company B, and you say, okay, you take this entire division and pay me 5,000. Okay, so what happens is, in this case, I am not saying that what is the worth of my plant and machinery. I'm not saying what is the worth of my debtors. I'm not saying what is the worth of my creditors or land or whatever it might be. But I am taking a consolidated lump sum payment, which is this 5,000 rupees from company B, right? In this case, such a sale of business or such a sale of undertaking for a lump sum consideration is known as slum sale. So what we say is we have done a slum sale of unit B. In income tax, even this unit is considered as an asset. And therefore, when you sell this asset, the gains which arise from sale of this unit are chargeable to tax as capital gains. Right? Keeping this in mind, let us first understand what is the meaning of slum sale in legal or technical parlance. Slum sale means transfer of one or more undertakings. So we said we are transferring the undertaking in this case for a lump sum consideration, which was 5,000 in our example, without values being assigned to the individual assets and liabilities in such sales. I never assigned any individual value to the plant. I did not say my plant is out of this 5,000, 1,000 is towards my plant. So whenever a slum sale happens, the price is a single price. It is never broken down into individual components, right? If it is broken down into individual components, then it is a sale of assets. It's not a slum sale, right? So in a slum sale, what happens is you sell business for a lump sum consideration, right? One point which you need to note here is that in case of a slum sale, what may happen is that, let's say for example, you transfer two assets, land and plant and machinery, right? Now, if you know, land is chargeable to stamp duty on transfer, right? And stamp duty is levied based on some values. So even though you transfer the entire undertaking for 5,000, you might have to determine what is the value of land, because then you have to pay stamp duty on this. The mere fact that you have to determine the value of land for payment of stamp duty does not by itself dilutes the conclusion that it is a slum sale. Okay? The benefit of slum sale is that, you know, whosoever acquires this asset, so let's say company X acquired this asset or slum, this undertaking, they are able to claim higher depreciation. This you will learn as you grow in your life, okay? That is the reason why slum sales are done. The next point which you need to note out here is that determination of value of an asset or liability, stamp value, registration value, determination, etc. So just like I explained to you that, you know, you might have to determine the stamp duty, just because you are determining the stamp duty for the purpose of sorry, just because you are doing the valuation of land for the purpose of payment of stamp duty does not mean that this is not a slum sale. And this is what is supposed to be covered in point number 2. Determination of value of an asset solely for the purpose of payment of stamp duty, registration fees, or other similar taxes or fees shall not be regarded as assignment of values to individual assets and liabilities. So basically, what I told you was that for a slum sale, it is important that the consideration has to be lump sum. Just because you are determining the value of a land for payment of stamp duty does not by itself means that this is not a slum sale. It will always remain a slum sale as long as you are just determining this value for the purpose of payment of stamp duty or registration fees and other things. Now let's say, for example, once you have determined that this is a slum sale, then the next question is, how do you calculate capital gains? The determination of capital gain is given in section 50B, which we will now see. Now, according to section 50B, profits or gains arising from slum sale shall be chargeable as long-term capital gain of the previous year in which the transfer took place. So let's say, for example, you have an undertaking, okay, which you sold. To calculate capital gain, you have to know the sale consideration, which you can get from the agreement. So let's say the sale consideration is 5,000, right? Less cost of acquisition. The first thing is that these capital gain are long-term capital gain, unless where the undertaking are owned and held for not more than 36 months immediately preceding the date of transfer, these shall be treated as short-term capital gains. So if you are holding it for less than 36 months, then these are short-term capital gain. Else, this is a long-term capital gain. Cost of acquisition and cost of improvement. Now, once I know the sale consideration, the next question is, what is my cost of acquisition? Let us see that. Net worth of the undertaking shall be deemed to be the cost of acquisition and cost of improvement, and no indexation shall be available. So what we are trying to say here is, whatever is the net worth and how to calculate net worth is something which is given here. This will be treated as the cost of acquisition and cost of improvement, and there is no indexation which is to be available. CA certificate in form 3CA shall be furnished along with ROI certifying the correct computation of net worth under this section. So along with this, you also need to submit a CA certificate, right? The next question is, what is the net worth, or the which is treated as cost of acquisition and cost of improvement? Aggregate value of the total assets of the undertaking or division, revaluation ignored. Okay, so you have to club what is the total value of all the assets, okay, less value of liabilities of such undertaking or division as appearing in its books of accounts. So you see, what is the total value of the assets? From that you reduce total value of liabilities. The difference between the two is net worth, which is treated as cost of acquisition. Now, even to calculate the total value of assets, there are two kinds of assets: depreciable assets, the written down value has to be taken, right? For expenditure, for assets where the expenditure has been allowed or is allowable as a deduction under section 35 AD, the value will be nil. And for other assets, the book value will be considered. We'll take an example covering the question and explaining all these points. Other points, stock transfer shall not give rise to business income. So now, even, you know, when you are transferring this on a lump sum basis, you pay capital gains on this, even if some stock is included in the total asset schedule. Right?